Well, it finally happened. We got to watch Prehistoric Planet. And boy, do I have a lot to talk about here. In case you haven't heard from any of your super dinosaur freak friends, Prehistoric is a speculative nature type of documentary which just premiered this month of May. Maybe you've seen something similar like 1999's Walking with Dinosaurs. I personally always really loved getting to watch stuff like this since they always ask questions such as, what if? We definitely saw a pretty good number of these type of documentaries back in the 2000s and 2010s. Of course, while we received plenty of garbage types, it's really wonderful to get to see ones such as Prehistoric Planet, which uses up-to-date research and is depicting them as living, breathing animals. The episodes are able to blend real-life footage of scenery and other little critters, and adding CGI dinosaurs on top of it. It's a really exciting way to see how these animals might have interacted with each other in the wild, and of course introduces audiences, both paleo nerds as well as the general public, to many new dinosaurs that maybe they aren't as familiar with in pop culture, and can also just breathe a new life into these animals. And of course, this is a pretty huge project which includes a hefty roster of names that had worked on this. One of the main executive producers on this project was Jon Favreau, and he was an interesting person to have on board this project, considering that he directed the 2019 Lion King remake, which was questionable, but I will let that slide. Our narrator for this documentary series is none other than Sir David Attenborough, who honestly might be the real dinosaur here, at the ripe old age of 96. Most of us are familiar with him narrating shows like Planet Earth, Blue Planet, Natural World, and so on. And of course, this series also has numerous different experts in the field consulting for this project. We have people like Darren Naish, Steve Bravat, Susanna Maidment, Liz Martin Silverstone, very qualified people to speak on the subject. This documentary series consists of 5 different episodes taking place in different ecosystems. Seriously though, it is quite the spectacle, and there's only so much my words can tell you, but if you haven't seen it and maybe you just need someone to convince you to, I will happily do that for you. I'll briefly talk about what each episode contains and go in a little bit as to what I like about them and how accurate they seem to be. And all right, here we go then. Episode 1, Kos. What better way to kick the series off than by showing off swimming T-Rex? Not only that, but he is also shown as being more than just an absentee parent. It might come across as being a little bit bizarre seeing a T-Rex depicted as swimming. There's actually a rather short list of animals that can't swim. Not only that, but there are plenty of animals alive today that may not look like they are built for traveling in the water, but obviously we can tell that they do. So, in my opinion, it's not an obscene thing to witness. Of course, with many nature documentaries, we are shown the harsh reality that not all young will survive to adulthood. So I am happy that they did not shy away from infant deaths. When looking at the model of the adult T-Rex, he honestly looks very impressive. And we can also see that he has a light fuzz covering his body, but also depicted as having scales. And then, of course, as you can see, the babies are depicted as having a very full, fluffy, vivid coat. I personally really love this design, as it looks like their coloring and pattern makes them really eligible for camouflaging in the forest, which of course we can see with plenty of other birds today. As I was watching this episode, I was just reminded that one of the T-Rex chicks in this episode was really making me think of my house's cat, Maiko. And here is a cute little photo of her. She is definitely the type to try to hunt for something, but then doesn't really know what to do with it afterwards, so I just wanted to throw that in there. Another thing that I really appreciate about these models is that they are depicted as having layers of flesh on their bodies, which unfortunately in a lot of paleo media, we don't always get to see. You'll see people refer to this as shrink wrapping. It's where a lot of people seem to have the skeleton of the animal and they just wrap skin around it. They fail to account for things like fat and muscle, so they generally look pretty lean than probably what they would have in life. You'll especially see this on the dinosaur heads, as things such as the fenestra holes are incredibly apparent on certain dinosaur models. So overall, this was a wonderful way to start the series. Again, I think the designs of them look wonderful. They look so real and alive. It's just wonderful to get to see this right off the bat. After getting to look at beautiful coastal sceneries, including animals that were alive then, such as jellyfish, coral, stingrays, etc., we are then treated to seeing certain animals having different parenting styles. On a beach, there are numerous different types of pterosaur species. We see one known as Tethy Draco, who is protecting her chicks in a very maternal way, while the mother of the Alcyone chicks simply leaves her eggs alone on a cliff to figure things out for themselves. So this was another wonderful point that the documentary was sure to show us, in that there was no one right way to parent the young. Different animals would have done things very differently, as again, we see this in modern animals today. Some parents are going to look after their young for an extended period of time, while other parents will have their young fend for themselves. The practical effect of the newly hatched pterosaur chick rising from the seaweed was absolutely beautiful. Something about the breathing just looked very real to me. Now, as far as other things go, such as the pterosaur anatomy and how they held their wings, I'll be honest, I am not the biggest pterosaur expert out there. I tend to focus a bit more on dinosaurs specifically, so I do think I want to do a future video where I look a little bit into the accuracy of just how they're positioning the wings and so on. Up next, we get to take a look at some aquatic reptiles. We get to watch a couple of Tuarangisaurus, which are a type of elasmosaurid, gobble up some stones and use them as gastroliths. We've found this throughout the fossil record in different animals such as dinosaurs. I'm a little unsure if we've found them in these aquatic reptiles, so I'll have to look into that. But we do see this activity in animals alive today, especially birds. They don't actually chew their food when they eat it, so these stones, or gastroliths, will literally grind up the food they have eaten in their stomachs, making the digestive process a lot easier on them. I really love how they just depicted the teeth on these guys. They were aquatic animals, so they likely wouldn't have needed any sort of a lip structure. So it makes sense to just keep them exposed since they live in the water. And while the baby is busy eating rocks, we see the mama get it on with a mate. So that happened. Up next, we get a look at Hoffman's Mosasaur, who I think was depicted beautifully here. I absolutely love the design of this one. And rather than show it as a vicious killing machine, he is simply getting his skin cleaned by fish, crustaceans, and other creatures like that. Much like their relatives, monitor lizards do shed their skin, so it makes sense that Mosasaur would do this as well. This was another practical effect where the skin just looked very real to me, and it was honestly a beautiful scene watching the little sea creatures just nibble up the skin. Oh, to be a Mosasaur enjoying the sunshine on a spa day. I also really appreciate how they depicted them as swimming. It's theorized that they would have moved their body in a horizontal manner, giving it a very serpentine-like movement in the water. There's even a moment where they mention that the shattered teeth of Mosasaurs have been found in other Mosasaurs' skull, which is true. This is direct evidence of interspecies combat, so the episode shows them as fighting for territory. Now, this next scene is probably one of my favorites out of this episode. It's a speculative take on how Ammonites would have interacted in the ocean together. We see them congregate for mating displays, and they show off their bioluminescence. And wow, what an incredible sight this moment was. In real life, we do have some squid species that show off a glowing skin, so it's not crazy to think that maybe Ammonites had done it as well. And yeah, this was probably one of my favorite parts of the episode, right next to the fluffy T-Rex, of course. And to finish the episode off, we return back to the mother Tuarangisaur, who then proceeds to give live birth in the water. It truly is a beautiful way, I think, to finish this episode off. We are obviously introduced to themes such as survival and the circle of life here. So I'm happy that they seem to be keeping this at a very realistic standard, while also being a little bit speculative as far as behaviors or other things such as how they looked go. So overall, this is the first episode in the series. While very, very few dinosaurs were depicted in it, it was really nice to get to see so much of the aquatic life. And I've been near marine on for a little bit, so I do think I'm going to have to cut this video here. So I will go ahead and just get to work on doing the rest of the episodes for you guys. I'd love to know what you thought of Prehistoric Planet, or maybe you haven't watched it just yet. Feel free to comment your thoughts down below, and maybe even consider giving this video a like if you learned anything new. Thanks so much again for watching this, and I'll see you guys next time.